shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I've changed.
Good morning. Would you stand with us this morning?
Wandering into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul. Trying with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. Just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know. He told me is in the wind. No longer my old friends, burdens and bitterness. Yeah, just keep them moving. Now you ain't welcome here. Now till I walk the streets of gold, I sing of how you saved my soul.
Back home, you pick me up, you turn me around.
Amen, amen, amen. Why don't you go ahead and welcome the person next to you to the house of the Lord today.
Well, good morning, everyone. I am so glad you're here today. I hope you are refreshed today as you're here at church, right? The world will tell us that we are bound, right? But with Jesus, we are free. You are free today, right? How many of you have ever felt like you are in a grave, right? You are dead. You have nothing left to give. But with Jesus, there is hope. Amen? I love that song. I thank God. So good. So this morning in your bulletin, just a few things we're going to talk about. There's your Connect card. I know we go through this every week, but if you're a visitor, we have a Connect card in our bulletin. We just want you to take that out, and sometime during the service, just fill that out. Let us know you were here today. If you have a praise report, something you need prayer for on the back of the card, there are things you can mark on the back there just to let us know. We want to connect with you. We want to know what's going on in your life. We care about you. We love you. So fill that out throughout the service. Just a couple things going on this week. There's lots in the bulletin, but I'm just going to highlight a few of them. So tonight is our church family dinner meeting at 5 o'clock. You are all welcome. It's a free dinner. We're serving soup and salad tonight. We would love for all of you to come, especially if you're a member. We're going to just be going over some important details. So if you can make it tonight, please come. If anyone is free right after church to help set up tables and chairs for that, we could use your help upstairs in the stadium. So if you're free to help with that, please do so. A couple other things. So this Wednesday is what we call National See You at the Pole Day. That is taking place at the school, Northeast School District. Actually, it's taking place globally. It's a global prayer movement led by students. They will be praying for their school districts, our nation, their administration, their friends, family, community, and they will be gathering around flagpoles globally, like I said, and at Northeast, it's happening at 7 o'clock. It will be happening across the nation. So if you're free and you want to join us, the teenagers who were there will be provided after prayer with donuts and hot chocolate and chocolate milk, but come and pray and support them. If you can't come at 7 o'clock on Wednesday, please stop and say a prayer for our school district, for the administration, for the students, as we all join together to pray for them, for the teachers, for this coming school year. And then thirdly, I just want to highlight our life groups will be kicking off. Mark your calendars for October 6th. We will be having our harvest party. A food truck will be coming. We'll be meeting down here at the pavilion. We would love for you all to be there. So mark your calendar and join us for that. Now, if you would stand and join us as we continue to worship, let's go forward and worship.
Search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade, I never knew. When you came along and you put me back together. Is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all. dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn bread into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn
song of ages to the land.
song forever.
You are all these. gather here today, Lord, because you are worthy. You deserve our praise. You deserve our love. You deserve our thanks. You deserve our time and our attention. Praise your holy name. Praise your holy name. Father, we know that you're with us today. We're not alone. You inhabit the praises of your people. And so in the name of Jesus, we pray, Holy Spirit, touch our brothers and our sisters today. Encourage them where they feel weak. Build faith where there is doubt. Lord, and give courage where there is fear. And Lord, give comfort where there is pain. Comfort my brothers and my sisters. Would you go ahead and place your hand on the shoulder of someone next to you? Say a word of prayer over them. Jesus, move in my brother and my sister. Holy Spirit, have your way in their life today. Let them know that they know that you're with them and they're not alone. Help them, Lord, to believe all things are possible. No, life seems to be hard. Build their faith today. Move in their life. We ask it today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to continue in an atmosphere of prayer. If you would like to place on your Connect card on the back a prayer request or a praise report, we'd love to do that. And this video is the Lord's Prayer. Jesus said, this is how to pray. And we committed ourselves to be a house of prayer. He said, my Father's house will be a house of prayer. So we're just going to take a moment. And this is just a prayer guide Jesus gives us for prayer. Immediately after the prayer video, we have a promo for our services that are coming up.
Hi, friends. Evangelist Greg Hubbard here. We are so excited about the upcoming meetings there at your church. Want to take a few moments and highlight a couple of areas that I believe can help make this time most effective as possible. The first area is the five-friend focus. This is a simple but effective way where each person focuses on five family or friends, and they pray and invite them to the services. The churches that have gone after this, have implemented this, the results have been supernatural. I want to challenge you, even right now, to think of five people and pray for them and invite them. And we'll be praying with you, believe in God, for the salvation of their soul. The second area is that of expectation, and that's all about prayer. If we pray and fast and seek God's face, it's then and only then that we can come together and expect the Lord to move and do great things. We're praying about these meetings with you. We're coming. We want to give it everything that we have. So let's prepare. Let's pray. Let's invite people. And let's believe God to open the heavens over these services and to move and touch every life. God bless you. We'll see you real soon.
How many want God to move in one of your family members, one of your friends? We're believing for that and praying for that. It's going to be a special time next week. Sunday morning, they'll be with us. Sunday night, Monday night, and Tuesday night. So if your friend says, no, I can't make it that night, I'm booked. You say, well, there's actually three other times. So please come and join me. Before I share from the Word, I want to thank you again for your generous offerings. The Bible does say when we give in our offerings, we are to give with expectation. That's another word for faith. It says, sow sparingly and you will reap sparingly, but sow bountifully and you will reap bountifully. Now, I often thought that meant, well, if I give more money in the offering, God will give more money back to me. That's not what that's about. It's if we sow generously, there'll be a harvest, a bigger harvest than if you sow sparingly. It means more people will be impacted. And so giving in the offering is an act of faith for the sake of God's kingdom and his glory, not for what we can get back out of it. So thank you again for your generous giving. I want to remind you, we're in this initiative called Pave the Way. We're walking into a big parking lot project. We're hoping by the end of October, each of us can make some level of commitment and submit that on a card coming up. Okay? Today we're going to talk about the importance of communion or the Lord's Supper. We see it in these cups that we have and the pieces of the bread, or you go to a Catholic church and you walk up and you get a wafer in your mouth and you drink from the cup. What's the deal with that? Why is this such a prominent practice in the church? So go ahead and turn to 1 Corinthians in your Bible, whether you have it in your hand or your phone. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Our series title is, As for Me and My House, As for Me and My Family, This is What We Do. That's our series title. Again, this is a letter written to a local church by its founding pastor, the Apostle Paul. After 5 years of existing together, doing church together, this church has all kinds of problems and a lot of great questions. And so Paul writes this letter to them to help address their questions. Last week we looked at the issue of whether it's okay or not okay for men and women to wear head coverings. That was last week. We saw that the real issue there was all about the importance of always positioning ourselves under God's headship. It pays to be under God's headship. And everybody said, amen. Paul started by saying to them, I praise you for holding to my teachings. But now, as he addresses another problem, how they were celebrating communion, he says, I have no praise for you. They were doing it wrong. You ever think about doing communion wrong? Taking it the wrong way? It was supposed to be about celebrating their salvation through Jesus, but it became something else. We're going to see what he says about it. So as we're using the series title, As For Me In My House, today it's As For Me In My House, we will celebrate our unity in salvation. Communion is a celebration of our oneness together with Christ and with each other. That's what communion is supposed to be about. And remembering Jesus' death that way keeps me from God's discipline. Yikes, we'll get back to that. God does discipline. We'll see that. The Corinthians were doing it wrong. To understand the problem, you need to understand the practice. For them, communion was part of a feast. They called it a love feast. A love feast was basically a church meal together, a time of fellowship and food. How many like that? Fellowship and food. Okay, we're going to have one tonight. We hope you all come. Free soup and salad and homemade bread, okay? We're also going to celebrate the Lord's communion together as we're being taught today. Seriously, everybody's invited. Come together as the body tonight to get updated on some things in the church and just to enjoy our fellowship together. It's upstairs in the stadium. A love feast was basically a church meal, a time to get together and enjoy. Again, we're doing that tonight. They called these meals love feasts. We could start doing that. Hey, tonight we're having a love feast. Okay? Two great words, love and feast. Who doesn't love that? Okay? Which gets to the part of the problem. The particular church family Paul's addressing, they had more feast than love. And Pastor Paul's going to call them out on it. We're going to see what he has to say. We'll come back to that. But it seems that what they would do is they would all bring some food to share. All the food was pooled together for everyone to enjoy together like a potluck. You can imagine some people brought in crock pots full of delicious meat, and probably the young single guys brought a bag of chips. You know, you brought what you could. And as an extension of the meal together, they celebrated the Lord's Supper, the love feast. But the people in the Corinthian church weren't doing it right. Let's look at how upset Paul is and why he's upset. We're starting in verse 17, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He said, in the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In other words, I don't like your church. I don't like the way you're doing things at your church. What are they doing that's wrong? How could you mess up the Lord's Supper? Notice he says, when you guys get together, it's hurting people more than it's helping people. You're doing more harm than you're doing good. That had to be like a punch in the gut when they read this letter. The way they were doing ministries, getting criticized. No one likes to be corrected or criticized. Imagine how this would have made them feel. It's definitely not a well done, good and faithful servant. It's a, I have no praise for you at all. Verse 18, what's so wrong? Well, in the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions. There are divisions among you. And to some extent, I believe it. You've already shown you're divided on so many other things. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. Your differences show some of you truly have God's approval. Some of you don't. Question, how would you like to be told you don't have God's approval? He said, so then, when you come together, it's not the Lord's Supper you eat. You call it the Lord's Supper, but it's not. Watch this. For when you are eating, here's the problem. Some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. Some of you aren't waiting for the others. You're divided. You're causing division. Instead of waiting for everyone to enjoy the meal together, you go fill your own plate up and sit down with your own clique. And you eat in your own little groups. This isn't what the Lord's Supper is about. As a result, he says, one person remains hungry. You eat all their food. And another gets drunk. Some of you may be thinking, I want to go to that church. Another round for everybody. Cheers. Don't miss this. People were getting drunk in church. No wonder Paul says, I got to write them a letter. 1 Corinthians. I like the Message paraphrase. Instead of eating the Lord's Supper, you bring in a lot of food from the outside and make pigs of yourselves. Some are left out and go home hungry. Others have to be carried out, too drunk to walk. I can't believe it. This is not the Lord's Supper. Three issues at least. Selfishness. Favoritism. These are my people. Those other people, fend for yourself. Drunkenness. Three things that can ruin a church service or communion service: eating too much, favoring your own little group too much, and drinking too much. This was not the proper way to celebrate communion. Paul wants them to say, as for me and my house, we will celebrate our unity in salvation. They were not thinking of Christ. They were not celebrating their salvation. They weren't thinking of others. They were thinking of themselves. Not the kind of church Paul says you should be. This causes divisions. Verse 22. Don't you have homes to eat and drink? I love that. You know, you should eat your suppers before you come and enjoy the Lord's Supper. Or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? There are those among you who don't have as much, and you're humiliating them and you are leaving them out. It's like kids in the school cafeteria. No one will sit with them. It's heartbreaking. Yeah, you have a feast, but you don't have love. Some love feast this is. What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter. This is no way to celebrate the Lord's Supper. It seems the wealthier people were ignoring the poorer people. Makes me think of the widows. Remember the widows when the church first started? When the church first started at Pentecost, the widows were being overlooked in the distribution of food. You remember that? This tells us we are a church to work together, so no one is overlooked. But this reminded me of those widows. I don't know if this included the love feast and the celebration of that, their communion time. But in this church, there was a problem. It lacked loving unity. This passage also makes me think of last week. We talked about headship and how man is to take responsibility to provide loving leadership. The responsibility as head. Someone came up to me after service and they asked, well, what about widows? You know, because we don't have a man to take that leadership. And that was a great question. And I remember in the moment we talked about how, well, ultimately God is our head, so we trust in him. But at the same time, as a church and brothers and sisters, there should be especially some men to say, we're not going to overlook the widows and help out where we can. So that made me think of that also. Paul says we need to treat those without in loving ways. But beyond that, at their church gatherings, notice there was no real focus on Jesus. I just got to say, boy, That was a great worship time today, wasn't it? And I just became overcome by the Holy Spirit as I worshiped over here. Just feeling like God's presence on me. Thinking of the angels and us together worshiping with them. Holy, holy, worthy, worthy. They weren't thinking of Jesus. They weren't focusing on him. If they were focusing on Christ, they would have been more thoughtful of others. This was supposed to be a Christian fellowship, but they had fellowship without Christ. This was supposed to be a time to celebrate with what Jesus had done for all of them. It was supposed to be a time for them to come together and remember together. We are here because of Jesus. Paul reminds them what it's supposed to be about in verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. You guys know this. I passed it on to you. Remember the first Lord's Supper? The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed by Judas, he took some bread at the supper time. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And then he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The bread is a symbol of my body that's broken for you. When I'm gone, do this to remember me, my body broken. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink in remembrance of me." Remember me. Two things we do on a regular basis so we never forget what Jesus has done for us. We take the Lord's Supper, have communion, and we celebrate water baptisms. Two ordinances that always remind us of Jesus and what he's done for all of us. The Corinthian church had forgotten what this moment was supposed to be about. Churches are in danger of forgetting what church is about. This meal was to include bread and wine, symbolizing their union. To remember, no matter how rich or poor, no matter who can bring much or who can only bring a little, no matter where each of them were in the political spectrum or their personal spiritual journey, they were all the same under Jesus. We are united because of the blood of Jesus. Everyone is a sinner who Jesus died for. Nobody is better than anybody else. And everybody said, this is the church. Sinners united together under Christ. Together celebrating our salvation. All have sinned and fall short of God's glory. Everyone who calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. We, all of us together, because of our belief in Jesus, we are all washed clean of every sin. We're all forgiven as God's gift to us. We are all saved from hell. Communion was to unite them together in their belief that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And for all of us, it's for all of us, and he is the way to the Father for all of us. Jesus says, when you do this, have this meal, remember you, who you are and what I've done for all of you. You've probably seen in the news recently a comment by the Pope rejecting this very truth. He spoke against what Jesus wanted all of us to do. He spoke against exactly what Paul is teaching is important for this Corinthian church. Here's what the Pope said: all religions are a path to God. That's blasphemy. It's heresy. No. one religion that is a path to God is the one that acknowledges Jesus as the Son of God and the only way to the Father. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. It's about Jesus. Every time we have communion, we are gathered in his church together. We are retelling what Jesus has done for all of us together. But it's about Jesus. Now watch this, verse 27. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. What's an unworthy manner? The way the Corinthians were doing it. Some of them were only thinking of themselves, neglecting the needs of others. They were having private suppers instead of celebrating their unity with the whole body. I thought about that. I wonder how big the church was. I really don't know. I know those churches at the time, they didn't really have church buildings. They met in homes. But they were neglecting the needs of others and having their private suppers. They were eating food in a way that caused others to go hungry. And instead of filling their minds with the glory of Jesus, they were getting drunk on wine. Paul says, I have no praise for you. You should be saying, as for me and my house, we will celebrate our unity in salvation. We're all sinners, saved by God's grace. So what does Paul want them to do? Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ, we'll pause there for a second. I always took that to mean giving Jesus' body that was broken the proper respect as you're having communion. But I now see it's actually both. His body and the church body. You can't properly partake in the Lord's Supper without being mindful of everyone else. Our brothers and our sisters and the unity that we all have together in Jesus. This is a profoundly strong Bible passage that speaks of the importance of being part of a church, a body of believers. You know, there's some people say, I can be a Christian, I don't have to go to church. This passage is definitely clear on the importance of being with the body, celebrating Jesus with the body. When the church doesn't come together and participate in communion, as it should specifically, here's what happens. Watch this. They eat and drink judgment on themselves. Everyone say judgment. Everyone say yikes. That's strong language. We'll see in a moment that word actually means discipline. It's not like God, I'm going to hell for that. It's discipline. We'll see that in a moment. You want to bring God's judgment on you? Paul's saying there are consequences when we don't do this properly. Think of that. It's a very big deal to do this in a worthy manner. Examine your motives. Test your heart. Come to this meal in holy awe. The depth of the love Jesus has for all of us. Wow. You say, as for me and my house, we're going to celebrate our unity in salvation. Here's the big idea. Remembering Jesus' death, what he's done for me, keeps me from God's discipline. Some powerful language coming up related to that. This is something that no one wants to hear. God disciplines those that he loves. We could spend a lot of time on that truth. You know what that should remind us of? He knows. He knows what we're doing. He's very aware of our actions and our attitudes. God is involved in our lives. He sees. And everything he does is to be helpful. He's present. And he's working in us. This is what this is telling us. We don't want to hear that God disciplines, but we don't like that, but we should, because he disciplines those that he loves. Paul's telling this church that he planted and a church that he and loves, when you fail to honor Jesus and the body the way that you should, there are consequences. I mean, he's not gaining popularity votes for saying that. You can imagine. He wants to be influential in their lives, but he's willing to say the hard things. There's consequences for the way you're acting. He details three specific ones. This should kind of rock your world. Verse 30. That is why many, everyone say many. Again, I don't know how many were there, but many of them in this church. That's why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. That's not they're sleeping in church. He's talking about death. Many of you have died. Some of you. He says, many are weak and sick, and a number have died. It seems to me, when we're not honoring the church as we should, we're not celebrating together what Jesus has done for all of us like we should, and men, I think especially, if we aren't lovingly leading our families in the practice of celebrating Jesus with the body in unity with other believers, we can become weak. Another word is powerless. We lose power. We feel we can't. We can't. We're weak. We can become physically ill or even die before our time. This is a crazy verse here. Paul says this was the case for many of them. They were a church under God's judgment, discipline. Why? They didn't love Jesus as they should, and they didn't love each other as they should, specifically through their celebration of the Lord's Supper. Verse 31. But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, how we honor and love or dishonor Jesus' body and the church body, if we were more discerning of ourselves and how we were viewing them and treating them and honoring them or dishonoring them, we would not come under such judgment. So to turn things around, Paul says, give an honest assessment of yourself. Think this through. Examine yourself. I've got to ask, do my life priorities show my honor towards the church? Am I tending to be selfish and only just thinking of myself? Have I been truly celebrating my unity with others in salvation? Do I tend to have more feasts than love? How would I rate my love for my church? How would I rate my love truly for Christ? How it makes sense, he says, more discernment leads to less judgment. Paul explains judgment here in the next verse. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined because he loves us, so that we will not be finally condemned with the world. Again, there's a lot of strong language in here. A lot of people would just rather skip over or not really talk about. We could spend a lot of time on that one verse alone, just taking it for what it says. In our sin, God will sometimes allow us to hurt, become weak and powerless, sometimes allow us to get sick or even die to keep us from hell. That's what it appears to be saying, to be condemned. The goal of his discipline is to help us change course so we don't end up condemned with the world. The church is to be different. Notice a couple of things here. Those without Jesus are condemned. This is why we take these special services very seriously. Greg and Robin Hubbard coming. God's gifted them in the area of evangelism and speaking clearly the gospel to those who don't know Christ. It's why we're challenging everyone to the five friend focus. Write down five family members or friends and pray over them and invite them to come to a service, because we really believe this. Another thing to get from this is God's love is so big that discipline for believers can include premature death to keep them from being condemned. The Message paraphrase says it this way: better to be confronted by the master now than to face a fiery confrontation later. Verse 32 could be used as an argument. I was thinking this through concerning the security of our salvation. You know, some people say, once saved, always saved. And other people view, well, you can be saved as an act of free will, but you still have a free will to reject Christ, and you can walk away. Different views on that. Sometimes the arguments are a matter of semantics. But in that verse there, verse 32, one could say, see, God will allow them to die before they end up turning so far away from God, they lose their salvation and then are condemned. They can lose their salvation. Another could say, see, they are so safe with God, even if he has to take them early, they will always be safe in their salvation. Look at that verse in a couple different ways. It's interesting. But either way, two ways the Corinthian church can solve the problem. I love how simple Paul keeps it. So then, my brothers and my sisters, when you gather to eat, you should all eat together. Make sure you're coming together with your brothers and sisters. I'm assuming you're going to keep gathering as the body and come together, and not separately in special cliques or in ways that show favoritism. And anyone who is hungry should eat something at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. This will prevent overlooking others, and it'll prevent drunkenness. And then he ends it with, and when I come, I'll give further directions. I know this might be fully explanatory, but I'll come and share more when I arrive. Again, I like the Message paraphrase. If you're so hungry that you can't wait to be served, go home and get a sandwich. But by no means risk turning this meal into an eating and drinking binge or a family squabble. It's a spiritual meal. It's a love feast. It's a time to remember Jesus and all who call on his name will be saved. Paul's like, we are to say, as for me and my house, we will celebrate our unity in salvation. Remembering Jesus' death keeps me from God's discipline. Would you bow your head with me? Imagine a church where people are just committed to getting together, to celebrate Jesus together. Imagine a church where everyone's making an effort, trying to do their best so no one is overlooked. Imagine a body of believers so passionate to pursue Jesus and to get others to Jesus. Father, thank you for your word. And thank you for the clear reminder, Lord, of the value of being together and celebrating you. Thank you for the reminder, Lord, that on the opposite end of discipline for doing things incorrectly, there is blessing and strength for coming together and doing it properly. We receive you fresh again today, Father, and ask you for your continued work and all that we do. I don't know where everybody is here today, but definitely a powerful scripture that reminds us of our need to be in a right place to examine ourselves with Jesus. If you know, you haven't entered into that journey yet, this is a good day to say it's time. It's time for me to allow Jesus to be head of my life. It's also a good reminder for all of us of the importance of staying on mission for those who don't know Jesus yet. So I want to ask that you would stand with me. We're going to have a closing song, if you would stand. And we're just going to take a moment as an expression of expectation, as Greg mentioned in the video, and as an expression of surrender for whatever God wants to do in my life, I want to ask that we all come forward, and we're going to take a moment in this last song to pray for our upcoming services, pray for the circle of the five friends that you may have, and pray for the lost that they would come to Jesus through these ministries, okay? Come on up, if you would. Don't be shy. Let's just take a moment. Let's take a moment to pray. Let's tell God we're expecting you to move. Some of you are at a place where, I need refreshing myself. Lord, refresh me. Prepare me, Lord, for what you have as Greg and Robin come. So we're going to sing and also just pray in your own way. Let's pray for those that don't know Christ.
Search the world, it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade, never enough. You came along, you put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
break into circles of 4 to 6. Go ahead and do that. Break into four circles of 4 to 6. And then at least one person in the group, if you would lead out in prayer for those in the group, for God's favor as they invite people to the upcoming services, and just for God's blessing over their lives, okay? Go ahead and break into groups of 4 to 6. Encourage at least one person. Prayer is simple. You just talk to God and say, bless my brothers and my sisters. Show your favor. Turn to your group members, give them a fist bump and say, I love you, and so does the Lord. See you tonight at 5 o'clock. Soup and salad, homemade bread. Come and join us. We'll break bread together.